Hey, Pedro Salomão from São Paulo, and he will speak about Sharpe's historic inequalities for spheres of a revolution.
Thank you very much. Is it working? Okay. Yeah. So thank you very much for the invitation. Very proud to be here. So I'm going to talk about systolic inequalities for spheres of revolution. And this is joint with Alberto Abbondandolo. Barney Braham and Umberto Rinievich. Okay, so the manifold here is always the two sphere, and first I will consider a Riemannian metric G. In general, we consider the following function on the space of metrics. We take G and we compute L min of G. We take the square and divide by the area of G, where L min of G is just the length of the shortest non-constant, of course, closed geodesic. Okay, so essentially we study this function here and we try to understand some properties of it. So for instance, this number can be made very small. For instance, you start with a metric, and then you change a little bit this metric to create a closed geodesic, which has very small length. So, and you don't change too much the area. So this number can be made very small. Okay. But if we try to make this number large, then we fail. In fact, there is a theorem by Crook. I think it's 1988, which says that sup of the systolic ratio is finite. In fact, there is an estimate for this upper bound, and in this paper, I think he gets this 961, this number, for an upper bound. But then this number was improved; this upper bound was lowered. Works by Saburo, Nabutovsky, Hotman, and in the end, there is this paper by Hotman. So this is Crook. That 32 is an upper bound. I think this is 2006. Okay, but if you consider the let's say G0, the round metric, then the systolic ratio of this is very easy to compute. And we have the great circles. Let's say take radius equal to 1 inside R3. Then the length L min is 2 pi, and the area is 4 pi, and the systolic ratio is equal to pi, and we are here. So maybe, what's the best upper bound? Could it be pi? In some other situations where people compute the systolic ratio, for instance, RP2, the systolic ratio of the round a metric would give the maximum of the systolic ratio. But it's not the case here on S2. If you consider like an equilateral triangle, you take a copy of it, and then you glue these two copies along the boundary. It's a singular metric on the two sphere. Then you smooth it a little bit, and you can even take it to have positive curvature. Then you can make this systolic ratio to be very close to this number, which is greater than pi, even with positive curvature. So there is a conjecture. This is the Calabi-Croak example. There is a conjecture that this number would be the best upper bound for the systolic ratio. But if you study, so here is the round metric, let's say in the space of metrics. And nearby, it's very well understood the space of Zoll metrics. All geodesics are closed with the same prime period. And all of them have the same systolic ratio. So Balashev studied metrics which are close to the round one. And he considered some curves passing through the round metric, and he proved not only he, but a paper also together with Alvarez Paiva, he proved that for almost all curves in some sense, if you compute the systolic ratio along a curve, there is a strict maximum at the round metric. So essentially, this curve cannot be too much tangent to the space of Zoll metrics. Then you have this strict maximum. And this led to a conjecture that the round metric is kind of a local maximum of the systolic ratio in the space of metric with some topology. So we used to call this conjecture the Babenko-Balashev, because I think that Babenko suggested this problem to Balashev, and then he worked on that. And eventually, we proved the following theorem, which proves this conjecture that the round metric is a local maximum for the systolic ratio. Let's assume that G has positive curvature and is pinched by this constant here. This is something about 0.8. Then the systolic ratio of G is less or equal than pi, and equality only holds if and only if G is all. So this is in some sense a large neighborhood of the round metric. Although you have this constant pinch in the curvature, it's still in situ topology some large neighborhood here, and that's true that this is a local maximum. Observe that you may you can deform those examples to produce something which has exactly pi as the systolic ratio, but it's not so. But inside this neighborhood, if the systolic ratio is equal to pi, then it must be so. Okay. To prove this, we use some mixture of classical Riemannian geometry and some techniques in symplectic geometry. No high technology, in fact. We follow some ideas of Poincaré and Birkhoff, old ideas, and goes more or less as follows. When the curvature is positive, then Birkhoff knows that there is a simple closed geodesic, so that the Birkhoff annulus associated to the simple closed geodesic is a global surface of section for the flow. And even the closed geodesic with least length is simple in this case. And so we have this global surface of section associated to the Birkhoff annulus. For a simple closed geodesic, which is the minimal, which realizes the minimal length. And then what we show is the following property. This first return map for the flow, so there is this annulus, there is the first return time, the first return map, the dynamics, the geodesic flow on the unit tangent bundle is encoded in this map here. It has this the following property. We call it monotone because the image of a vertical segment like that is always, when you go up here, it always goes up. So it's monotone. When that happens, then we have a generating function, which here will be just a function in the annulus. It's a special generating function. And then this generating function connects these quantities, which initially they look unrelated. And then you can estimate the systolic ratio. For instance, the area is essentially integrating this function. The fixed points, which correspond to closed geodesics that we are interested in, are the critical points of this generating function. And the value of the generating functions at the critical points are exactly the length of these closed geodesics. So it connects these quantities in a very suitable way so that we can prove that the systolic ratio is equal to pi. This is essentially, we use these classical comparison theorems to obtain this monotonicity. Okay, so, but the theorem that I would like to talk today, so this is, I will write ABHS, the joint work with them, and here also. So this is a recent theorem. Probably in the archive very soon, which says the following. So then Alvarez Paiva asked us if it was true that every surface of evolution, the systolic ratio, would be bounded by pi. Then, of course, you can have surface of, so it's a very small space inside the matrix, but still you have a lot of things which are outside. Estimating the systolic ratio in general is really difficult. And so if you are outside, maybe you can obtain this sharp systolic ratio with some extra symmetry, and this symmetry is exactly assuming that the matrix is induced by a surface of evolution. So the theorem is the following. S is a sphere of evolution. So it induces a metric on the two sphere. It's also bounded by pi and equality. If and only if, GS is all. Essentially, the same estimate here. But now, so it's a bit different, the argument, but still, we have a situation which in some ways is not as good as this one, but because of the symmetry, we can overcome these difficulties and prove this inequality. But then I have to say something about Finsler, right? So we worked in the natural Finsler, non-reversible Finsler metric here, which is considering Zermelo navigation on the surface of evolution. So let's take this as the z-axis, xy, the natural ones, and theta is this angle around the z-axis, and we can consider the wind is the vector field on S, which is just a constant times d theta. And this constant must satisfy this condition here. R max is just the maximum radius of our surface of evolution. And then for each point on the surface of evolution, we can consider the indicatrix, which is just the original one of the Euclidean metric, shifted by this vector. Okay, so this is, let's say, T1S, and this is T1S. Plus the wind, and this induces a non-reversible Hunders metric on the two sphere that I will denote by GA. So the second part of this theorem states that So that's one, and here is two. The systolic ratio of this Finsler metric which is the definition is natural in the problem. You take the length of the shortest closed geodesic for that metric and you divide it by the area, and here the area is the Holmes-Thomson area. Of the Finsler metric, and the theorem says that this is also bounded by pi for any a, but when a is non-zero, then it's strictly less than pi. So let's say a is positive, it's strictly less than pi. So when you turn on the wind, the systolic ratio goes down. So the area here that we consider is this area that can compute as computed as follows. This is we take the volume of the unit bundle of this metric and divided by 2 pi. And the volume here is the contact volume. Like we have the Hilbert form and we can restrict it to the unit tangent bundle. It's a contact form. And so it defines a volume form here and we integrate it. And we obtain okay, let me give an idea of the proof of this theorem. So we consider the following coordinates in this three manifold here. One of them is this theta. We have to define the curve here which determines the surface of revolution. So we take this curve parametrized by arc length, R of S, Z of S. S is the arc length. And is S goes, is in this interval here, from 0 to M over 2, where M is the length of a meridian. And R is the distance to the z-axis.
Okay.
And if you consider the unit vectors, so let me give a proof in the case E equal to 0. The unit vectors here, at each point, we can just give an angle, call it beta, which is the angle with this d theta. So we have these three coordinates, S, theta, and beta, which parametrizes the unit tangent bundle. And the equations which give the geodesics, so the geodesic flow, is determined by the following equations. Theta dot is cosine of beta divided by R of S. So here is S equal to 0, and there is S equal to M over 2. And beta dot is equal to R prime the derivative of this function here, and S dot is equal to sine beta. It's very simple, in fact. So these are the equations which whose solutions are the geodesics on the surface of evolution. And we see that because of the symmetry, this side here does not depend on theta. And this subsystem here is independent. It depends only on S and beta. It is determined after you solve this. So if we look at and it's also very easy to check that Clairaut is constant along the trajectories. And so we can draw the level sets of this function here, which is, I will draw only part of it from minus pi over 2 to pi over 2, which means that I just consider the solutions which are moving in this direction. It's symmetric, so the solutions in the other direction are essentially the same. And here what we see is, so this function is preserved. So of course here is S equal to 0. Better to put it here. We see something like that here. This is a level of this function. Maybe here we have something similar. Maybe also here. So the solutions here, they are like that. In this side they go up, and this other side they go down. So it's very simple. This is essentially the geodesic flow on S. And then you have this third coordinate that you can integrate later. So to estimate the systolic ratio, what we do is the following. So we have the equators. Equator, I mean a point, a parallel, which is a closed geodesic. For instance, in this picture here, we have only one equator there, because an equator, a parallel to be a closed geodesic, must, the derivative of R must be equal to 0. And so we consider the equator with least ratio. The radius we call R min, which is the radius which is defined and then we take a parallel or an equator with radius R min. It always exists. And we consider the Birkhoff annulus. Associated to P0. And we look at the first return time, the first return map to this annulus. So in this picture here, this is a point, this is an equator, this is a critical point of R, and the Birkhoff annulus is just the annulus which projects here. So we can see that all trajectories, it's not a global surface of section for the flow, but all trajectories will hit it back. So we have a first return map, we have a first return time, but it's not a global surface of section. So we try to estimate the volume and the systolic ratio looking at this map here. So and this map it has coordinates theta and beta. We change these coordinates to xi theta and minus cosine beta. So these are new coordinates in this Birkhoff annulus. And we look this map in these coordinates. This is what we call eta. And this map has the following form because of Clairaut's first integral. It has the form that it preserves eta, because when you return, you have the same angle. And it's a map like that. There is a shift in this theta direction, which depends only on the angle. Yeah.
So then every geodesic comes back.
Comes back. If it's the.
No.
It cannot because, well, it's an open annulus. Yeah. So if you think as the Clairaut first integral, it's the radius times cosine. So the Clairaut constant for that solution is very small. So it cannot accumulate, because that's the least radius. If it accumulated somewhere else, it would be an equator with even a smaller radius. So everything comes back. It's exactly this picture here. So in the beginning, I said about generating functions. So this eta is a parameter in this interval here. And we can consider a primitive of this function f. Satisfying the length so this function we can normalize this function to be so eta equal to zero is just a meridian, so we choose it to be equal to zero here, and the first return time is a function that we call tau. This is exactly the length for zero, the length of the meridian. And essentially this function here, which is the primitive of this guy which shifts, has all the information about the systolic ratio. So I will put some facts here, which can be checked quite easily, which is, so this the first return time is exactly f of eta minus eta f prime of eta. So this is the function f, and it must be symmetric because so f is odd because if you shoot a geodesic with certain angle with respect to the meridian, it will go back exactly at minus of the point. So this function here is odd, which implies that f is even. So it's a function like that. And the first return time, which is that expression that we see there, it's essentially if you choose a point here and take the tangent to this graph, this is the value of the first return time. And so what we can prove is, so this function here is always bigger than L times the norm of eta, which is always above. And if we can compute the volume, first, so a critical point of this function is just a point where this guy is equal to zero, so it's a closed geodesic. And if we compute at a critical point here, we see that the value of the function is equal exactly to the first return time, or exactly the length of this closed geodesic. So it's a it has a good property as a generating function, and the volume of it's in fact just a computation. It's you have to integrate this function, uh, plus the integral of so this gamma is just that region that I put before, and here is the Birkhoff annulus, this is gamma, we have to integrate this function here. And then, so with this formula for the volume, what we do is the following. If that equator, because that equator is a candidate for the systole, so if it's not the systole, then it's it satisfies this property because this is pi times area. So if it's less, or in fact we can assume that it's strictly larger, then otherwise we are done because this ratio is less or equal than pi. So if you have this inequality, you assume that that equator is not the systole, then so this is greater than zero, because this is the least radius, and these guys here at that region are bigger. And so if you use this inequality here, that the volume is less than twice L squared, then we obtain that the integral of f is less or equal than L. Or let me put strictly less than L. And then this is essentially the value of L. And if the integral of this function here is less than L, since this value is greater than L, we can compute it. It must have a critical point which is below L, its value. So there is a critical point which has value less than L. And now because F is greater than that function, the integral of F will be greater than this region here. So the value of this guy let's call it mu. And so the integral of f will be strictly greater than that area, the dashed area there, which is mu plus 1/2 L minus mu over L square. And then, using again this inequality here, that the volume is greater than this expression here, because this is at least zero, we finally obtain that the volume is greater than if you just replace this value here in that integral, you obtain that this is strictly greater than mu square twice. And but mu square is just the length of a closed geodesic gamma associated to this point of minimum here. It's a fixed point of the first return map. So, and then the length of this closed geodesic square is less than the volume which is equal to pi times area of GA, which is the systolic inequality. At some point I just assume that this function here is not constant, because if it's constant then the first return map is just the identity, and we can show that in this case it's so. So I assume that this is not constant. So then we have this inequality, which is just the systolic ratio for the metric. Sorry, I put GA here, but this proof is for A equal to zero. It's the Riemannian case. So, yeah, when we put the wind, the volume, it's not so difficult to see that the volume increases. And L mean, in most of the cases, it decreases. So the Katok examples is, we can see that. When we put the wind, the equator, it survives, and its length in one direction decreases, and in the other direction increases, but the total volume decreases. In the general situation, this function here is not even, it's a bit more complicated, because we may not have such critical points. But then, if we assume that the equator with least length, which is in the direction of the wind, does not satisfy the systolic ratio, then it must have a critical point. And that critical point will play the role of the systole. It will give the systolic inequality for GA. For the Finsler metric, and so we proved this theorem like that. Thank you very much.
Wait a moment.
Thanks. So in Finsler geometry, are there so is there an analog of the theorem of Krog?
In Finsler, yes.
So there's a
there is an upper bound. Sometimes this upper bound is different from the Riemannian one, but there is. Mm-hmm.
And are there worse examples? So then this double triangle in the Finsler build.
Examples which gives systolic ratio above that one?
Mm-hmm.
No.
No. Okay.
No. It's a good question.
Is there any difference if you consider the Hausdorff-Boltzmann volume? for this historic ratio?
Because we use the formalism of Hebb flows, this is the natural area that we should consider. I don't know if what happens with the systolic ratio if you consider different.
Because in the Randers case it's more natural, the Hausdorff, because you can compute independence of the norm of the one form and the Riemannian method.
I don't know what happens. We just consider this one.
Mm-hmm. Have you thought about what happens beyond A equal to 1? So when you leave the realm of Finsler geometry and have what maybe would be called a strong magnetic field? I mean, of course, at some point the inequality must be violated, yeah?
Yeah, what... So the Riemannian case, you have this systolic inequality, and in the Finsler case also, if you increase the space for Hebb flows, you don't have any more. It's unbounded. The systolic ratio, you can make it very high. So I don't know exactly when you don't have this, you shift too much this.
Yeah, but then it's not contact anymore. Yeah?
Yeah, it's not contact anymore. So I would guess that...
Something similar, yeah?
Yeah, it's even worse, you know.
Have questions?
Okay.
I just maybe have a comment to your question. So the Boosman volume, so it's larger than the Holmes-Thompson, so it is the inequality is in the right direction then. So it gets better.
It's larger. It's larger, yeah.
Yeah, so the Boosman volume is larger than the Holmes-Thompson. So you get the same inequality.
Other questions? Okay, if not, let's thank Pedro again. And we resume at 10:40.
Yeah, sorry for jumping with my talk instead of Dio Boraga. Maybe it would be clever to leave the slot empty, but we really waited for Boraga until yesterday evening. But from our side, I do hope that my talk is kind of summary of, not summary, but it's very related to some talks of the conference, but I do give another view on this point. So I will speak again on Finsler metric constant curvature, similar to Robert, similar to Professor Moore, similar to Thomas Mettler. Maybe somebody else is missing, yeah? But it really speaks from different viewpoint. As you see, the result is though joined with Robert Bryant, Sergei Ivanov, who was here, Patrick Foulon, who was here, and Wolfgang Siri, who was in the previous conference. And let me just start with history of Finsler metric, because Mark Trojanov in his talk said it's 100 years, he lied, it is more. Yeah? So they did appear explicitly in Riemann's habitation address, and he even wrote a formula for them. Unfortunately, he said that they are not interesting. Yeah? He said no sense, hat kein Sinn, yeah? No sense to consider them. Yeah, but he did not really got agreement. So habitation address is a talk, a lecture which you are given to other member of department, more or less your first lecture for the department. Yeah, and it is normally not published, but this one was so influential that it was published about 40 years after it was given with a preface of great mathematician. So Hermann Weyl, who wrote preface to it, disagreed with him. He said, no, they do have sense. And what he explicitly suggested to consider was what now are known under the name Bierwald and monochromatic metrics. So precisely this, yeah, it was just explicitly, I mean, it was different words, but there was definition inside, which appeared many times during the conference, and actually which are not the subject of my talks. But still, if you even forget this, they appeared before Finsler. In fact, Finsler was a student of Cradori, and just this matrix, some theorem which he proved. I mean, the name is kind of, is really not, Finsler not deserve to be named by after Finsler matrix, yeah? So he just did not do his studies, and after he did not study them, yeah? But Theodore Landsberg did study them, and their motivation was the following. You know, it's the beginning of 20th century. It was the time when Levi-Civita calculus appears, Riemann curvature appears, I mean, and actually, it was one explain how this object, Jacobi vector fields, Riemann curvature, so how they effectively work in describing behavior of geodesics. Yeah? So Cartiodori, Landsberg, and some other people actually wanted to mimic this description for the optimal problems. And the restriction that Finsler matrix are one homogeneous, it is not a restriction. So just you simply take different levels of the energy and rescale it some that they are one homogeneous. So it's Finsler matrix are actually more or less any, well, with some non-degenerous assumption, continuous optimal variational problem. So I will speak about matrix of constant flag curvature. And they, in fact, already appeared in 1908. I mean, Landsberg did not say the word flag. The word flag appeared later. But in fact, he did introduce what now is called flat curvature in dimension 2. And also asked, it was not direct asked, but say it would be good to describe matrix of constant flag curvature on surfaces. He really worked on surfaces. So, and it's clear why, yeah? I mean, his game was to generalize the methods from methods which worked in Riemannian geometry to Finsler geometry, yeah? Constant curvature is the first best object in Riemann geometry. Let us look what is the first best object in Finsler geometry looks like. Basically, locally and macro-locally, it's not problem they exist, the metric of constant curvature. I mean, this even without any science, curvature is, as an object, is just a function on the unit tension bundle, so it is a function of three variables, right? Condition is constant is one PDE. So, I mean, what we are doing, we are studying some PDE of very special form, of three dimensional on one function. And of course, there are, if nothing is completely artificial, there are tons of solutions. So you actually have seen different approaches to questions, different ways to study this PDE, and you have seen that even after additional strong geometric assumptions, we have a lot of functionally parameterized spaces of solutions, so it's really a lot. Let us now stick to the global case. Global understands that on the closed surfaces, and then there are three cases. Zero curvature, negative curvature, constant of all this, and positive curvature. Negative and zero curvature are done. And they were done in 1988 by, I don't know, French mathematician of Iranian origin, Iranian mathematician working in France, Akbar Zadeh, who proved that every closed two-dimensional surface with constant negative curvature is actually Riemannian. So locally there are a lot of freedom, globally there is none, yeah? For zero curvature, result is the same, but it's locally Minkowski, and it's also completely understood then. So just the torus with Minkowski vector quotient by the group. The result is two-dimensional, but in the case of negative curvature, it's also multidimensional due to Patrick Foulon 1997. Patrick is not here, so this is the result which make Patrick Foulon, yeah? It's short paper, but it's completely new circle of ideas inside. But the last case remaining is positive curvature. It is different, yeah? So, you know, in the previous case we had no examples. In this case there are many examples, but all of them are reversible. And I will possibly discuss on the end. So, Alberto, I have tendency to take more time than I'm expected, so please stop me, yeah? So this discussion's end is possibly too optimistic, yeah? But if Albert doesn't stop me, yeah? I explain where the examples come from and link it to the talks of previous speakers. But I will recall the so-called Katok metric, which many of you possibly know. So there are at least non-trivial examples. And the irreversibility here is important, and this is due to Robert Bryant. I put here 2002-2006 because basically the main work in my understanding was done in 2002, and the formally the statement was announced 2006. Yeah, there was though some reference to Mason and Lebrun, which was used, which I still don't understand how important it is. And the state that there is no reversible Finsler metric of constant positive log curvature is remaining. So the only case which is not done, it is positive flag curvature, and the metric is essentially irreversible. So let me now speak about the statement. It is main theorem. I don't know. No, the year is a question. Yeah. So it's still preprint. So when the paper appears, if it appears, the year will be changed. So, well, you can read it. Yeah. Geodesic flow of any metric of constant flag curvature, I make it plus one, it's really not restriction, yeah, I just rescale it, on the two sphere is symplectically conjugated to that of an appropriate Katok metric. I will recall for you what are Katok metric in the next, after the next slide. And symplectic conjugacy means the existence of symplectomorphism of the split tension bundle to that of the Katok metric, which takes F to F Katok, yeah? So this symplectomorphism does not really see any geometry. So it's not commute with natural projection. It does not really behave well when you go down to the manifold. So So it's indeed a So there is a conjugacy, but nothing more. Yeah. But you know. Again, if Albert does not stop me properly, yeah, I will explain that this step, though visually we are solving other problem, is indeed important step in solution of the main goal, namely the problem asked by Landsberg, namely describing all metric of constant curvature on closed. Well, Landsberg did not ask for closed surfaces. So let me now go to Katok example, and I recall for you what you already have been recalled by previous speakers, what are thermal transformation Katok metrics. I do it from possibly other perspective. So the word thermal transformation appeared many times. Maybe somebody knows it, but it always appears by formula. Let me draw a picture. So, what is Finsler metric? Finsler metric is at every tangent space we have the unit ball or unit sphere. And this unit sphere contains all information about the Minkowski norm at this point. So we have a tangent space and a unit ball. Yeah? What is Thermal transformation with respect to vector field V? It is we take this unit ball and translated it, moved it by our vector field. That's all. Of course, there are some conditions should be assumed, so the result is a Finsler metric, and the condition is that vector field is not very big in this sense. Yeah. Now, Katok metric, by definitions, are Thermal transformations of Riemannian metric of constant positive curvature by Killian vector fields. So, in two dimension, there is only one metric of constant positive curvature, and essentially there is one Killian vector field, yeah, up to conformation. Basically not one, it's interval of them, because you multiply it by constant. So this is the metric, this is vector field, the parameter you can choose is alpha, which is at most one, yeah? If alpha is zero, the results remain metric, and you simply write down the formula, which possibly appeared sometimes during the conference, but geometry is explained here. Actually, just mentioned that Katok passed away recently, and Dion Boraga, who actually should have spoken here, was going to dedicate his talk to Anatoly Katok, great mathematician. So, for example, this example, it's a side note in his paper. His paper was dealing with some different stuff. I mean, nobody noted this example unless somebody recovered later. Now let me go to three-dimensional transformation. And now I assume that our vector field is Killing, which is the case in Katok metric. Let me list this effect. So I possibly give some reference behind. Suppose now V used for three-dimensional transformation is a Killing vector field. And let me call the three-dimensional transform by F tilde. Then geodesics of the initial metric and geodesics of the Katok of the three-dimensional transformation are very closely related, and this is the relation. If you have geodesic gamma of F, and if where is the notion? How what's letter? Psi t is the flow of the Killing vector field, then psi t of gamma of t is geodesic of F tilde. Look that here we have t two times, yeah? One times t, one times t. So it's not a translation of geodesic, but you translate any vector for different time, yeah? So it kind of deviates from the initial geodesic more and more when the time goes up, yeah? I will make the picture on the blackboard in a minute. So geodesic related, and the flag curvatures are also related. So the flag curvature of F tilde and flag curvature of initial are the same. So x is a point on the manifold, so it's the same plane. And these vectors where the flag curvature is calculated are actually precisely the natural vector related by the shifting along the vector field V. Yeah? So actually, I mean, for me, the flag curvature is constant. So the statement is if this is constant, this is constant as well. Yeah? For example, the references are here, both facts, or maybe the second one, don't know. Well, at least the second fact was observed by Foulon, but not published. Then it was republished different people. So it appeared in Havaloyes, Vittorio, 2014, and Li Huang, Mo, 2015. And, all proofs are complicated. The fact is easier, so we just write down elementary proof for it. Yeah. Let me just. This one is not very important. So it says curvature is the same. So say if you stay Katok metric, that the curvature is still constant because for remaining metric constant curvature, the flag curvature is constant one. Yeah. What I now play is with this property. I play with this on the blackboard. And what I'm trying to do for you now is to make the picture of geodesic of the Katok metric. So it is on the standard sphere, and I will work in the standard spherical coordinate. So this coordinate will be called theta for me, and it's a range from minus p divided by 2 until p divided by 2, and the equator of the sphere is just this line, yeah? And this coordinate, okay, it's not very parallel in my case, and this coordinate will be called phi, and this is the second coordinate, so this correspond to meridians, Gaussian meridians, and this correspond to parallels, yeah? Let me start a point and send first normal geodesic of the initial remaining metric constant this point. And you know how it is. It goes to equator, cross equator, and in time pi, it arrives, let us think that the coordinate theta is zero on this point. At time pi, it arrives in the point, just opposite point, yeah, just. And actually, all, every geodesic does it, yeah? Then in continuous, and the time 2 pi, it arrives precisely to this point, this line is glued to this, and then continue periodically. Let me now do the same, but adding the wind, adding the wind, which is the vector field V. And I play with this formula. So it starts from the same point, yeah? For t is 0, the same one. Then it goes, and it goes kind of each time. This is kind of, let me call it distance, not the distance, start to be bigger and bigger and bigger, linearly bigger. So it arrives not, it goes up to the same height, but arrives, this distance is pi times alpha, because, I mean, it is just what, so the flow of V, phi t of, I don't know, theta phi is theta phi plus alpha t, yeah? In time p, it arrives here, yeah? Then it goes further, yeah? And then it appears here, yeah? So it's not close anymore, yeah? It's not close anymore. Then it continues. If you have luck, it comes to the same point, so geodesic is close. If you don't have luck, it starts to be so irrational winding on the bus, and the luck or not luck is alpha irrational or alpha rational, yeah? If it's rational, and it's actually the same picture for any other geodesic. So because if you take other geodesic of standard metric, you again come to this point, and because you take other geodesic of this one, you again come to this point. So geodesic coming from here in the Katok metric gather in some point. It's not opposite point because there's no notion opposite in the time pi. So this picture we will see all metric of constant curvature. So let me repeat again. I mean, there is actually one exceptional geodesic, namely the equator. Geometrically, it's the same curve. But if you go one direction, you go faster. If you go another direction, you go slower. Yeah. So it's geometrically the same curve, but the length is different whether you go in one or other direction. So let me just summarize. If alpha is rational, then all geodesic are periodic. And all but at most two have the same length. The two which doesn't have the same length is the equator. And actually, one can calculate that this two special geodesic, the sum of reciprocal of the length is 1 divided by pi. If alpha is irrational, then all geodesic by 2 are not periodic, only 2 are periodic. And again, the sum of reciprocal is less is pi. Now, these two properties which are listed here are not properties of special system, but property of geodesic flow, yeah? So if geodesic flow are conjugate, which I claimed, the same property are true for any metric of constant curvature. So, well, all of these properties remain true for each metric constant curvature plus one. And actually, the length of the shorter geodesic determines the geodesic flow of the metric of constant curvature plus one, because it determines this number alpha just as you see, yeah? It is really the question how to formulate the main theorem, yeah? We have five authors, four of them have very strong character, yeah? So I do like the way to formulate how I did. It is conjugate two. But by voting, we did decide that the paper, this statement came as the main important. I'm still don't agree with it, but, you know, we have different opinions. Let me now explain what led to the proof. And first was non-trivial statement. At the end, it started to be kind of trivial. I'm happy to finish because possibly we would throw it away, would we not finish it just and say, because it's triviality, why should we publish this, yeah? So for me, it's based on three theorems. In the paper, other proof appeared. The first theorem is the following. Geodesic flow of metric of positive constant flat curvature is Liouville integrable. If you don't know what it is, don't be afraid. Liouville integrability means there exists a function on the tangent bundle, on the union tangent bundle, which is constant on orbits. We denote this integral by I. This is a very strong condition on the behavior of geodesics. So it, in this small dimension, it means that most geodesics, which we view as curves on tangent bundles, live on the two tori and two tori are just the common level surfaces of set where f equal to 1. One is not important, you can rescale it, and I equal to constant. So the story is one parametric, parameterized by the value of constant. And actually, the geodesic line of the torus behaves very standard. It's a standard winding, winding on the torus. Sorry for my English. So basically, you possibly remember that if you have indeed standard linear flow on the torus, then the only invariant of this torus is the rotational number. So basically, the behavior on each torus is defined by one number. And the second theorem says that this number is the same. So we have one parameter value of torus, and each torus behavior is the same. Yeah. And the third theorem, theorem C, is, I mean, actually, in fact, if it's separators, we have many integrals, so one should be careful about it. But forgetting about being careful, ignore this. The Liouville foliation, so foliation two-dimensional four, it's singular one, has only, actually, precisely two singular fibers, which are circles. And they are elliptic singularities and Morse bot classification. Yeah? I do not explain what they are, but they come in the next, take it as a black box, they come in the next slide. So let me, I don't know whether you see behind the chairs, but let me just make the picture. I do the picture on the other. On my second part of the whiteboard, and the picture is the following. So my three-dimensional manifold, my unit tension bundle, which is RP3, look as follows. It is two-dimensional torus. Actually, a family of it, which degenerate to a circle. And it looks for you like a solid torus, but it's not. This manifold is RP3. Yeah. So this cycle going here is not that cycle. They have some intersection. They have two intersections actually with the cycles. Yeah. Now let me explain why main theorem follows from theorems A, B, and C. Well, in fact, I know it because I studied in the correct group. The correct group is a group of Fomenko. And at the end of my study, they study orbital equivalence of inner Hamiltonian system. Orbital equivalence is conjugacy, but we don't care about symplectic structure, and we do allow remagnetization of orbits. So it's, it's not conjugacy flow, but conjugacy of unparametrized flows. Yeah. So they actually did it for much more complicated situations that we have and constructed complete family of invariants. Complete family of invariants is really complicated, but our situation is easy. So if you take the shortcut of the result to OSA, is that in the system with this topological structure, this one, the circle, single circle, this one, family of tori, the only invariant, I mean, also if topology of manifold is fixed, is the rotational number. So two-shell system with the same rotational number are orbital equivalent. Yeah, I don't know whether it's the general theory is too deep, but this one is possibly you would believe it. Yeah, because look, rotational number describes the behavior of geodesic here, and it's the same here. Yeah. So the only thing you should care about how you glue this one-dimensional circle. I mean, just try to glue it differently, yeah? So this is the explanation, yeah? Well, there are still some issues. One issue is with smoothness. So we do want smooth conjugacy. And the system is also kind of known. In symplectic geometry, more or less observed by Zedanta, possibly write down this name again in my screen. Now, it is about orbital equivalence. So this follows from big theorem. Yeah? What about normal conjugacy and what about symplectic conjugacy? In fact, in these small dimensions, they are the same. So orbital equivalence implies symplectic equivalence. And in the case, say, when we have irrational flow, then this is in fact just action angle variables, yeah? So action angle variables will give you the symplectic conjugate. Again, one need to invest some time to understand that they behave correctly near the singular orbit, but at least it gives symplectic equivalence in regular domain, yeah, and then one needs to look at the glue correctly. So in the case if we do not have, if in the rational case, yeah, so globules are closed, the trick of Einstein combined with the result of Wetzel also do the job. So, you see that our theorem follows from A, B, and C, yeah? So let me now explain the result A, B, and C. I have 20 minutes, okay. And maybe I managed to do it. So, I possibly did not need to put the definition of Yerkes vector field here, but I put it here. It is the same as the Riemannian case. It is, if you have a family of geodesic, parameterized by C, it is derivative by C. The object is a vector field along geodesic. Yeah? It's normal if it's orthogonal to gamma dot. It's just a standard definition. It was more or less initial definition which is written in Landsberg. So I possibly also don't need to do example, but let me still do it here. Yeah? So let us consider the exponential map. And the picture here is not very good. I explain why not very good. I simply was lazy to do a normal picture. So it is exponential map from this point with respect to Finsler metric. And the picture is not good because this actually should be Finsler spheres. They should be curved. I make them round. Okay, I wrote somewhere that coordinates are nonlinear and such as f at 0 size r, yeah? But actually, it would be better if I just try to imagine that there is another one. But then, in this picture, if indeed, even in the round case, but also if the spheres are not round, but any other form, they should be hypothetically, the vector field is simply d by d phi, where phi is any parameterization of the circle, of course, hypothetically given to any one. Yeah? So just keep this picture in mind. Yeah? So Jacobi vector field in this exponential coordinate systems are simply, they still image with respect to differential of the exponential mapping of the tangent vector field to the spheres. Yeah? Now, let me finally use the condition that my metric has constant curvature. And what I write down is comparison of normal Jacobi vector fields of Finsler-Riemannian geodesics. And I do it here on the blackboard. And those who are doing metric geometry, please do not kill me after the lecture because it's definitely not comparison in your sense. Yeah? So I work locally in R2. It's not essential locally, it's not essential R2. And suppose we have a curve which is geodesic, but of two things. It is geodesic of F, and it is geodesic of some g tilde, which is a Riemannian metric. Yeah? Assume in addition that the flat curvature of F and Riemannian curvature of G are the same along geodesic. Gamma, gamma dot, and here is gamma, yeah? Assume also in addition that along this geodesic, how it's called, fundamental tensor of F is the same as G tilde. G taken in point gamma, gamma dot is equal, okay, let me do it white. G taking point gamma dot is equal to G tilde along geodesic, yeah? Then, let me just now run. Then, Jacobi vector fields are the same. So if you have Jacobi vector field for f, then it's just the same as for g tilde. Yeah, it's not very deep. Just differential equation for these guys are the same, and actually just because differential equation is controlled by curvature, and curvature is the same. So this is just one. I mean, here it's state constant, but the equation for the vector fields is linear, both in remain physical situation, so constant not essential. Yeah. In particular, if we have a covector field, say for f or for g, which is zero at a point, then it would be, and then, well, and if the curvature is constant, say positive, then the covector field behaves precisely as the one for the standard sphere. So in time pi, remember the number, 3.1. it starts to be zero again, yeah? So this is the message of this picture. And this will be used to construct the main instrument of the proof. It is the isometry which appears for free once we work with metric of constant curvature. So the isometry is the following. I mean, isometry is maybe from S2 to S2. The game is you give me point of S2, which I call P, and the output of the game is I give you another point, which should be phi of P. Psi of P, yeah? So, and the statement is the following. The definition is the following. Just take any geodesic starting from P, from P and go for time pi. This is. So the isometry is the following. Let me now change the picture. Take P, go time pi, and this would be f of P. So of course, just you would immediately assume cheating because there is a huge freedom. You can change geodesic. But if you take another geodesic, because the Jacobi vector fields behaves precisely as in the remaining situation, in time pi they are zero, so this geodesic comes precisely to the same point. Yeah? Basically, let me do it picture. Basically, if you take the spheres in this metric, then all of them homothetic to the sphere in the tangent bundle to the metric with coefficient which is precisely sign the same as in the standard round model, yeah? So, and it vanishes for Kp, so this sphere, I mean, first start to be bigger, but then in time pi, they start to be trivial. You also see that the manifold is a sphere, no choice. And the proof survives for all dimensions, it's just the same proof. We call this point phi of p. So again, the point phi of p is you start with any geodesic from point p and go for time pi. Yeah? Let me claim that phi is isometry. And it's actually trivial, let me explain one. Yeah? So what I claim it is that if you have two point p and q, then the distance between psi of p and psi of q is the same as the distance between p and q. Yeah? And I prove it as follows. What is psi of p? You take any geodesic starting from p and goes for time pi. I take this geodesic, the one going through q. Yeah? And you go the time pi, and by definition, you come to psi of p. Yeah? What is psi of q? You take any geodesic starting from here and go from time p. And I take again this geodesic. And this is psi of p. Yeah? So this time is p. So this is just p. This distance is pi. Yeah.
Q.
So this one is this one, right? And this is precisely what I want. The mapping is isometry. So it's not only this. So we do know the differential aspects of isometry. So differential is this vector is instead to this vector, differential of psi and vector to the vector of the same geodesic, but in one, yeah? So this one, you go by as geodesic and will be sent here. So, And this is here. So the mapping psi, even we iterated k time, send a point to the k time p geodesic going from this point, and the vector to the vector which is k time p, vector of the tangent vector to the geodesic, a point k time p. So, for example, if the metric is reversible, which appeared, for example, the talk of Kim, then phi square is literally 1 because you just go back, just it's just. And then this was one of the important properties which allowed to prove the theorem which I mentioned by Brown about reversibility. And for irreversible, this mapping is not antipodal. The square is not the isometry, simply because, say, for Katok metric, you have the form for the mapping, and dependent of alpha, it's really all powers of it can be different mappings. Let me now describe this mapping in the spherical coordinates. So I write a theorem. There exists a spherical coordinate system on the sphere, such that psi of theta phi, it is the spherical coordinates, is, well, you send theta to the minus theta, and you say phi to at lambda pi. Actually, lambda is related to alpha in the previous blackboard by something like lambda is equal to 1 plus alpha. Yeah? It is the same pictures we have here. All geodesic, starting from a point, come to time pi, to geodesic, to point, which has minus theta, so it was some theta, and this is minus theta, and which have, which is moved here by time lambda, and lambda here is, lambda is p alpha plus p, something like this, yeah? No, it's multiplied by p, so alpha plus 1. It is not very deep. Well, it's deep indeed. It's very deep, but everything was done by classics. So that observation attribute to Poincaré, we didn't find Poincaré, we didn't find the literature, so we wrote a proof. But actually, it's not very complicated proof that any isometry group of any dimensional sphere is a subgroup of the isometry group of certain metric constant curvature. So. On the same sphere. Each two-dimensional phenomena is relies on the uniformization theorem, yeah, and relies on study on conformal group of the two sphere. So, but that's it, yeah. So, okay, it's Riemannian, yeah. Why not? Why is not it?
You're proving this theorem, but I thought that that's the end of the entire proof.
No, I proved the theorem. This proves the theorem, yeah. And the reduction Finslet-Riemannian is just given, for example, by Binet-Legendre metric mentioned by Nikolaevsky. Now let us look on the group generated by phi and consider phi and consider its group generated and consider its closure in the group of isometries of F. Group of isometries of F is a closed group, so the closure is some commutative subgroup. There are two cases. This group is finite, which means that in some power k, phi k is equal to density, which means all geodesic are closed, and less small k pi. There could be some exceptional which goes many times, but besides this exceptional finitely many case, at most two, in fact, all of them k pi. Then the system is superintegral, and rotational number is constant. I mean, rotational number for any superintegral system is constant. And then, I mean, we just arrived to our theorem A, B, and C. I mean, one should be slightly careful because one needs to show the rotational number is one realized by the Katok metric. So this is some variational argument coming in play, which I wouldn't explain. Second case, the group is infinite. So we do have an infinite group of isometries, which implies that the closure of it is non-trivial Lie group. And then we have a Killing vector field. And in fact, the Killing vector field, because our group is simply, it is just shift along the phi sink, yeah? But then we have Killing vector field, and integrability follows again. So the last thing to show is that in this, also in this case, our rotational number is constant. Okay, let me just spring it in. So let me explain that Tesh number is the same for all Liouville tori. So I mean, our Killing vector field is d by d phi, yeah? So the flow of psi x by just adding t to phi coordinate. From other side, our isometry psi, which we started, is given by this formula. I mean, look, square of it, change the sign theta again. So square it, simply theta is the same, and this one you add 2 lambda pi. Now, if you take square and compose with minus 2 lambda pi flow of this vector field, you get identity. So, which means that this mapping, is identity. But this is just projection of the 2p Hamiltonian flow with the Hamiltonian, which is sum of the Hamiltonian of F and sum of Hamiltonian corresponding to this Killing vector field, p theta. Yeah? So we do have a linear combination of our Hamiltonian in integral, such that all its flows are closed, which implies the rational number is constant. Yeah? If it's not constant, then this any linear combinations will have rotation number which is also non-constant. Rotation number of the combination is the sum of rotation numbers, and then it would accept the values which are rational, which means the one. So this proves theorem B. Now theorem C, I probably skip it because I didn't explain what abort singularity, but just believe that it follows from Glissant, or at least it's trivial, but those who don't believe it's trivial can look on Glissant who proved much more complicated stuff with theorem. So let me go to the higher dimension. So suppose what survives? So suppose we have a constant flat curvature metric on a manifold of high dimension, then the manifold is still covered by the sphere. For reversal, metric is proved by Chen, but it's not, reversibility is not really the point here, so it was just one. I think it was mentioned in the talk of Robert Bryant. J flow of F still interval has no topological entropy, so it's still true. There are some subtle issues inside, yeah? So it's not completely. And either all geodesics are closed, or there exists a Killing vector field such that after thermal transform, what I did before trying, it is just thermal transform, all geodesics are closed. Actually, dimension 2, one can also make all geodesics to be of the same length 2 pi. So the summary of what you said before is that we describe geodesic flows of metric constant curvature. And now I explain how it may help to describe all metrics of constant curvature. Yeah? Geodesic flows seems to be, if you describe metric revolutions, you don't really go through geodesic flows, you just describe them all. Yeah? So here we do go through geodesic flow, and let me explain why. And this is just what I do is I overview the result which were mentioned many times in this audience, namely in by Bryant, by Mettler, and also I don't think by Moore, but maybe I just over here. And actually I was going to discuss it with Robert. We started to do it whether we continued. This definition you know appears also in previous talk. Remain metric is sol if geodesics are closed. In dimension 2, they're automatically of the same length. Now, the fact, the observation made by Bryant was later made by Mettler, which he also mentioned, that sol remain metric on S2, satisfies certain condition, allows to construct finitely metric constant curvature on S2. So there's duality. I will comment this later, but by this duality, you obtain not all Fischler metric, but satisfying special assumption, namely the assumption that all geodesics of the related Fischler metrics are also, as in sol case, they are close less to pi. Yeah? Let me give some conditions. First of all, if it works, it's open condition. Yeah? Second, it works on standard sphere, so if you just change slightly standard sphere being sol, you construct it, for example. And in fact, it's more general. So Bryant called, we can see non-geodesic, but beta geodesic, Mettler called them geodesic of wild connection. So it is really, there is one more freedom inside which you can do to chess construction, yeah? So, and construction is dual. So we geodesic of sol metric respond to points of the sphere. And this unit circle Stegen bank responds to geodesic metric. So it's basically replacing one by other. Yeah. So the proof, indeed, you look at the equations, structure equation, you see that structure equation survive if you replace one vector field to another vector field. Now, sol metrics were studied. There are many examples. And you know, we know that space sol metric is big, so locally they can be parameterized by functions of two variables with some symmetry property. It's odd function. Yeah? So there are also many which not have no symmetry. First, we construct already by Bljaski in 1924. So that's everything works, and this is more or less the description of Finster metric of constant curvature. Such that all geodesic are closed and they have lengths. And now we pass a situation where geodesic are not of the same length. If they're not closed, then other method works, in particular developed by Professor Mo. But the remaining case, if all of them closed, but not of the same length, yeah? And then the observation is that the construction survives if we start not from S2, but from remaining orbit field, such that still sol, all geodesic are closed, yeah? So what our theorem to geodesic flow says that how this orbit field should look like. So orbital, so it has at most two singular points because the geodesic flow has at most two special orbits and also gives the ratio of the, at this special. So what is the structure? What is the orbital structure in these points? So for, in particular, we start with weighted projective space. We come to Katok metric. Yeah, one need to do a conform representation, but it's minor. Yeah, and this is. And if you start with construction Tanner and sol, then we arrive to all rotationally symmetric metrics. And the construction which is there, you remember, you can choose any odd function on the sphere, or one variable, no sphere on the circle, give you essentially give you description of all possible Finster metrics. And so just provided that the theorem of Gulliman survive also for orbit field, we reduced our problem, the problem of Landsberg, to really remaining problem description of sol orbit folds with some additional condition, which is actually studied. For example, Christian Lange, who is here, really did a lot of notable results in that direction. So I am afraid Alberto would not stop me. So let me put the slide with conclusion. And thank you very much for hearing. Sorry for just jumping for with my talk. Yes, thank you very much.
Actually, I don't have a question, but usually it falls upon the last speaker or the last chair to thank the organizers. And since in this case they coincide with the organizers, I'd like to thank Marco, Vladimir, and Alberto for organizing this wonderful conference in a great place. Thank you.
So in high dimensions, indeed, there are examples of isometric groups which are not conjugate.
In dimension 3 is fine.
In dimension 3 is okay, but dimension 4 and higher, already everything four, breaks yeah. down. The place to read is a wonderful survey by Mike Davis on this stuff. So he collects all kinds of examples. So.
Other questions? Is this space of metric with constant and flat curvature is to believe to be connected?
Well, definitely not, because so okay, connected. What distance you consider? Just Hausdorff difference?
No, just if you can deform continuously.
It's a very good question. Yeah, it's a very good question. Yeah. Is the space of Zoll metrics connected?
I think it's unknown.
Yes, it is?
That's not known.
It's not known, yeah. Okay, good. Whatever. Ask any other problem for Phil's medal.
Known, but there are partial results. For instance, if you put if you put some symmetry, then it's connected. It's
if it's rotation is symmetric, they're all
connected. No, not only, but there's also what's connected is the space of Zoll-Finzel metric on RP2. Zoll-Finzel on RP2 is connected. Yeah.
Track of it, so are these good orbifolds? I mean, okay, there are two orbifold points. Do they have the same order?
No. If you have good, so if you say who have good, you unfold them and you just get the same Fischer metric.
Okay, so it's really the case of bad orbifolds.
You need to work with bad orbifolds. Yeah.
Okay.
Are there other questions? Okay, if not, let's thank Vladimir again.